I grew up in Chicago, and I was never much of a fisherman. However, when I was a very young child, in the summer, I think my dad was probably on a vacation, we would jump in a streetcar, boy, that's a long time ago, and take it to the shore of Lake Michigan. And we carried our fishing poles. There are large stone piers that reach out onto the lake. Put our fishing poles together. My mom would have packed an incredible kind of basket full of records. Hard-boiled eggs, sausage, bacon, sweet rolls, coffee cake. We would sit there. We must have gone out early because it was summer, but nonetheless, watch the sunset, sunrise over Lake Michigan. You can see all the tall buildings to the left of where our favorite spot was. And it was wonderful. But we never caught any fish. Not once. I once turned to my dad and said, "Daddy, why don't we catch fish?" He said, "Shut up, you're ruining it." So. Now, I know many of you in this cathedral here in the heartland of central Illinois are pretty good fishermen. You know where to go to catch fish. You know how to tease those fish out of the water. You're skilled at it. But let's face it, here in central Illinois, we pretty much fish for fun, for enjoyment, for the sport of it. Most of the Lord's earliest disciples were fishermen, and they were not fishing for fun. That was their livelihood. Galilee, with its famous lake there, the Sea of Gennesaret, it's sometimes called, was famous for producing fish. They were sold all over Galilee, and even further, the greatest catch was sardines. But all fish were first of all caught at the night so that the fishermen could sell their catch in the morning at the various marketplaces, or would have been salted, and they were exported all over, even as far away as outside the loop. And their survival depended upon being good fishermen. Now, I did a little study about this. The big fish would come in close to shore at night because the shoals there near the shore were warm water, And the apostles had been all night fishing and hadn't caught a thing. Jesus appears there and he gets in one of the boats, goes out of it. And again, there's a reason for that. They didn't have microphones. So the Lord in a boat with water around him could preach, and the large crowds could hear what he was saying. And the apostles were there kind of mending their nets. But listen, at a certain point the Lord says, "Go out into the deeper water and catch some fish." Peter, who often led with his mouth, he wasn't afraid to speak up even when he was wrong, said, "Lord, we've been fishing all night and we haven't caught a thing, but say so, we'll go out into that lake and put in our nets in." Well, always do what Jesus says. They put in their nets. They caught so many fish, the nets began to break. And Peter fell down on his knees when he got back ashore and said, "Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinner." But Jesus said, "Do not be afraid. I am going to make you fisher of men." And those fishermen, as the scripture says, left everything, their livelihood, their families, their home, and began to follow Jesus as his disciples. That is tended those talents and used those talents. You are taught to be of service in this world, to make this world a better place. And you all do it in different ways. All those badges. There isn't just one badge. Good guy, good girl. No, there's badges for specific skills. But I want to promise you, if you use all the skills of your youth, later adulthood, and middle age, and old age, if you use them with the Lord, you will work miracles. Not because you're perfect. Not because you never make a mistake. Not because you don't have some sin in your life. All disciples have some sin except for our blessed mother. But because you cling to Jesus Christ, no matter what anybody else says, no matter how this world scorns you, you belong to the Lord, and you will bring in an abundant catch of fish. I can't think of a better example of how Jesus works miracles using our little to make much than the Mass we are celebrating. Think of it. We come together, and what do we bring ourselves? We also bring something pretty ordinary, bread and wine. The bread is unleavened, has about the taste of cardboard, let's face it. The wine is of a very inferior vintage. It's very sweet, so it can survive in sacristies. If you are a connoisseur, you put your nose on that. It's our little. But through the word of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit, it truly becomes the body, the blood, the soul, and divinity of our risen Savior. It truly is the bread that has come down from heaven. We have our part to play, we bring our stuff, but God makes it wondrous beyond all compare. And a similar miracle should happen in our own lives. We bring who we are, but through God's word and the Holy Spirit, we become a part of what we receive. We share in a part of the Lord's life. We become His disciples. We become His evangelists. We too can win the whole world for our Savior. So all of us here, scouts especially, we are very proud of you. You aren't just sitting in front of a computer or a TV set. You're doing things. Keep that up all your lives. But let Jesus, His word, His teaching, His example, be the heart of who you are.